Hey, I'm Ethan from Leaky VWs, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to tune your Inventatronic ECU.
So once you have the entire Inventatronic ECU system installed on your car, the first step to tuning is to turn your key to accessory. As you can see from the little green light on the relay we have here, the ECU is now powered on.
So this is the Inventatronic Commander software. Now this is what we'll be using to tune and to basically utilize the Inventatronic ECU to run our car. So the first thing that I'm already noticing is that the ECU firmware that I am currently running is 4.1.2 and the Commander version is 4.1.5. Now if I try to do anything with this, it may not work correctly because the firmware on the ECU and the Commander are different. So what we have to do is we have to update the firmware of the ECU. So if I go and try to connect to the ECU, it will tell me that my firmware version 4.1.2 does not correspond with the Commander version of 4.1.5. So it's basically telling me that the incorrect operation of the system is possible. So now what we will do is we go to the firmware section and we're going to manually update the ECU. To do this, we go to the update button, and this should bring you to the file that you have downloaded from the Invent Labs website. And this right here is the file, the update file for the ECU. So we click on that and hit open. Now we'll see preparing, and this will now update the ECU. So as you can see, the firmware has 100% been updated and the ECU has now been disconnected. So now we can go back to the main and we can begin to set up our ECU. So the next thing we're going to do is to write a calibration to the ECU. So now that I have everything updated here, if I hit on to connect to the ECU, you can see here that the ECU has no calibrations in memory. To start the engine, write the calibration to the ECU. So basically, this is just saying that the ECU doesn't have any sort of tune within it. And in order to have the car actually start, we need to load a map onto the ECU. So to add a calibration to your ECU, simply click on the file button here, and then you're going to want to navigate to whatever calibration is for the engine that you're installing the ECU on. You're going to want an IMF file. The impart files are just for ignition tuning. The IMF file is for fuel. So in this case, I'm going to be using the Audi 4-cylinder 16 valve, and this is because this is the closest calibration on this version for the Volkswagen 16 valve. Now, in a later version of the software, there will be one specifically for the Volkswagen 16 valve, but until then, we're going to be using this one. So now this is uploaded to the Commander. We can click the download button to send it to the ECU. And that will send the calibration to the ECU. So now we have everything loaded up onto the ECU. We can go over to the main options section and we can select the type of engine that you will be tuning for. In my case, I'm doing this on a Volkswagen 16 valve. This is a PL, so that's the 1.8 liter 16 valve. And the closest one to that would be the 4-cylinder KE-Jet 16 valve, the AAD or ACE engine code. However, these are a little bit different than the Volkswagen, so I'll just be using the custom engine settings for now. And now the custom engine settings allows you to select precisely what your engine is going to be having. So in my case, my engine is a 1.8 liter for displacement. It is a 4-cylinder. We're just going to leave the max RPM at 6,500. The throttle switch does not need to be inverted in this sense. And other than that, everything is good here. Now, also, we can double check the injector settings in the injection settings. The Bosch 107 is the injector that I am using in this case. And we're going to leave all of the fuel correction on load for now. And then we're also going to make sure that the lambda control, the adaptation, is off for now. And then after that, we are going to double check a couple of other things. So now let's move over to the sensor tab. Over here, we're going to double check that all of our voltage and temperature readings are correct. Over here, you'll see the temperatures, and this is reading in degrees Celsius. You do not want to have any more than a 3 to 5 degree difference between these two sensors. If you do, it's likely that these calibrations are incorrect. In my case, I'm actually using a Jetronic sensor, so I'm going to change that just to make sure that there's no sort of finicky things when I start this. And for the IoT sensor, I'm using the one provided by Invent Labs, so I'm just going to leave this the way it is. For idle, for now, we're going to leave this all the same. Now we can go back to our main screen here. If we look down here in the input section, you should see that your idle is highlighted green. If this is not, you want to definitely double check that either you do not have the throttle switch inversions on, that you're using the correct engine setting, or that your wiring is correct. Also double check to see if any of these errors are highlighted red. If so, look at the instruction manual on Invent Labs, and that should tell you how to resolve any of these errors here. If these are red, then it means that these sensors are having issue reading or they're shorted to ground. So now let's verify that these switches are working correctly. As you can see, my foot is now on the pedal and the idle switch is still green. If I press the pedal a little bit, you'll see that green goes away. Now, if I continue to press the pedal, when I get to about 90%, you'll see that the full load switch comes on. And then there's still a little bit of 10% more to press. If you see that correct, just let off. See that the idle becomes green again, and then you'll know you're good. Just do a couple of varying speed tests just to make sure that everything is working and the switches are functioning as intended, and then you can move to the next step. So now that we have all of that checked and all of the settings are correct, we can now go to the first start. This is what I have set up for the 16 valve, and as you can see, the main is just pretty straightforward. I haven't touched anything with the sensors or the idle yet. We will get to adjusting this once we start the car. Now, starting the car, it might stumble a little bit on first startup, and that's because we have not calibrated the idle yet. But once you've checked over all of the checks and we are to this point, just try to start the car. And once it starts, try to keep it running so that the ECU can get a little bit of data from your car. We also want to make sure that the lambda adaptation is off for now. So I'm just going to make sure that that is correct. And then now we can get to our first start. Your car is running, you're probably noticing that your car is idling pretty high. So we can now move to the idle tab to make some adjustments. At the top idle RPM section, you can see two rows. The first row represents the engine's coolant temperature, and the bottom row represents the target RPM. So as the car warms up, the RPM should lower. So now let's get into tuning the idle of the car. So if you look over here at the engine temperature, you can see that my engine is warmed up and to temperature. You're going to want to make sure that your car is anywhere between 80 and 90 degrees Celsius before you start tuning your idle. So now if you look down here, you'll see this slider. Now, normally this will be disabled like this. And the function of this manual slider is to basically test how much percentage open the idle valve needs to be in order for your car to idle smoothly. So for right now, I'm just gonna move this off of zero just to disable the automatic idle tuning algorithm because I've already got mine configured for my car. But just for demonstration purposes, I'm going to send this to the ECU. So now we are in manual idle mode. So now if I start my car, so as you can see here, the RPM is kind of fluctuating roughly in the range we want it, but we want it to be much smoother. So what we're gonna have to do is we're gonna move this slider until we get to the point where the engine is idling happily. For Volkswagens, the valve actually begins to open at about 30% on the settings here due to how the valve electronics work. So if we send this to the ECU like this, you'll see the RPMs have shot up. And now this is because additional air is being allowed into the intake through the idle valve. This is much higher than we want it to be. So now I'm just going to start turning the slider back until the car starts to idle a little bit lower towards the target RPM range. So if you look up here, this is the target RPM range, and we should be shooting for around 850. So what I'm going to do is keep dialing this back until the car idles closer to 850. So because the valve closes at that 25% range, we're going to want to make sure that we stay above that range for the manual slider, or it won't really do anything in this case. So what I'm going to do is just send that over. So as you can see, the engine is idling much more happily around that 850 to 900 range. So now that we know that engine likes this 25% range for the idle valve, we can set that to our minimal position here. As you can see, I have the minimal position back a few percentages from that 25%, and this is to give the valve a little bit of range to work within the algorithm. For the 16 valves, you can just kind of follow the numbers I have here and just tweak it accordingly to how your car is set up based on exhaust and other sort of modifications you might have. For your cold start position at 0 degrees, you're going to want to make it about 3% higher than your minimal at temp percentage for the idle valve. This will be the minimal position when you first start your car. And this is something you want to check when your car is cold again and not up to temperature, just to see where the car idles happily around. You can use the same process that we did for the warm start as for the cold start. Up at the top of the screen, you can see the target RPM range. And at 0 degrees Celsius, you can see that my target RPM range is 1,040. As you can see, as the car starts to warm up, the RPM for the idle starts to decrease. Now, you can adjust these values, but you need to make sure that your Inventatronic ECU is set up to control the ignition. Otherwise, this algorithm won't work properly. So if your car is still set up to use the stock ignition system, do not change the target idle RPM range on this table. So once you're happy with how your idle is set up, make sure to turn off the manual slider as to disable the manual idle adjustment and to enable the idle algorithm once more. Now we can disconnect the commander software from the ECU and turn off our ignition. Now I can turn our ignition back on. So now I'm going to reconnect to the ECU. Now that we're connected, we want to make sure that the manual position is to 0% to enable the algorithm. And now we can send it to the ECU. And now if we start our car, it may take a second for the RPMs to drop down, but the RPM should slowly drop down to that target RPM range. Once you're happy with how your idle is set, now you can move to setting some of the other settings on the idle page. So the after start position, basically all that this does is just adds a little bit of percentage open to your valve for after start, just to make sure that it does not have a sharp drop too low where your engine stalls, or to have too much where your engine sort of kind of freezes up in the higher RPMs. For the hot air add, this is based off of your IAT sensors. So I have over here, we can see that my intake air temperature is at 38 degrees Celsius. And what this will do is this will add a percentage to the valve based on how hot or how cold my IATs are. So basically what this does is it will add 3.1% or whatever you have this value set to on every 20 degrees Celsius above the base temperature for the IAT sensor, which is 20 degrees Celsius. Now over here to the idle cutoff. So the idle cutoff is a function that activates when the accelerator pedal is fully released while driving in the gear. This saves fuel and also reduces emissions. So basically, once we hit 1800 RPMs and we're on D-cell, then the fuel supply will be cut to the engine. And then once we get below 1200 RPMs, the fuel will be resumed. And this delay is set here by seconds, so it is 1.5. So the corrections here is useful for things like if you have your AC hooked up. For example, if you select the AC for inputs or any of these other inputs for that sense, you can set a correction in order to help the car run better when you have that certain system on. Going down to the PID settings, your KI setting here is the most important coefficient out of all of these, and that is because it determines the speed at which the revs return to the target value in case of some sort of small deviation. So a good example of this is if our RPMs drop suddenly, this will allow the ECU to control the amount of air that's flowing through the IAC and allow it to send more air to keep the RPMs going up. So the KP settings determines how quickly the regulator responds to large deviations. This one is responsible for any sort of sudden changes. So for example, if you mat your car in a high gear and you're suddenly demanding more fuel, this will help to kind of regulate that system. And the KD setting limits the rate of speed drop after reducing the air to fuel supply. This doesn't have much impact on idle stability, but if it's set incorrectly, it can cause the engine to be very shaky. Now, if you want to learn a little bit more about the PID settings, I recommend looking at the instruction manual, as it's very clear about what each one of these does and how to kind of adjust each accordingly. However, usually this is set pretty good within the calibrations, but if you're seeing something with your particular setup that could be affected by any of these three variables, I would definitely look this up in the instruction manual. So now that we've adjusted the idle valve, we can go back to the main screen. From here, we can now adjust our fuel correction on load.
At this point, you're now ready to drive your car. So find a clear road, preferably one uphill if possible. If not, a large parking lot will also work. So all we have to do is rev the engine up to about 2,700 to 3,000 RPMs and try to hold it as consistent as possible. As you can see on the right side of the screen, you'll see the lambda correction. And this is the correction that the oxygen sensor is seeing and telling the ECU to either remove or add fuel. So what we're going to do here is we're going to actually subtract some of the value here from the fuel on load, and this will lower the amount of correction that the oxygen sensor has to do on load. So as you can see, as I'm lowering the value for fuel correction on load, it is increasing the number for lambda correction. So we want to bring the lambda correction as close to zero as possible. So just keep adjusting this fuel correction on load until your lambda correction value is close to zero. Once you're satisfied with the adjustments you have made to your fuel correction on load, stop driving and bring your car back to idle. So now if you bring the car back to idle, you'll see that the lambda correction value will change again. And this is because we still need to adjust the fuel correction on idle manually. This is the exact same concept as for the fuel correction on load. Either increase or decrease the value of the correction on idle to bring the lambda correction as close to zero as possible. It may take a second for the lambda correction value to change, but over time it will slowly either increase or decrease, and hopefully it will go closer to zero as intended. Now repeat this process of correcting the fuel on load and the fuel on idle 3 to 4 more times, as these values are interdependent and changing them also affects the other value. So now that we've set our injection settings, we can now move down to the lambda control and check the adaptation. Now this will clean up the rest of the tune while you're driving. And now your Inventatronic ECU is set up and your car is ready to drive normally.